Here we are again. We are in January still on Sunday afternoon. We are being recorded from Restoring Hope Community Church and from also my ministry, Heart of Glory Revisited. For those of you that are listening and that are maybe getting away from TV sets for a minute and getting away from Twitter and getting away from, of course, that's not that difficult nowadays, and any other form of technology that's going on, that we have this time this afternoon to talk about something that's near and dear to God's heart. And I believe it's a word that we need to be looking at in this hour. It's a word that we need to be taking, not just to heart, but hear me well, all of you guys and everyone that is listening and that is on live stream and those that are here today as well. We need to take this one to the streets. Hallelujah. And that I believe that every city, country, nation, even in this world, all over this world right now, I believe this message is something that we need to be really taking a strong look at. And the message, that when I was praying about it, the Lord had shared with me to call this message the Great Purge. Now, it's interesting because we all know, as we've been going through so much chaos and we've been going through so much that's gone on individually and corporately and in churches and in businesses and in cities and governments and everywhere that is going on, even last year and still going on this year, we need to look and see, what is God shaping us for? What is God sending to us in this hour? Where is it that we as a people, individually, corporately, whether you're in churches, whether you're in businesses, whether you're in homes, families, wherever it is, what is it that God wants from us? And when I was thinking about this, he brought me in talking about the Great Purge. Interesting. Watch this. We've had a few things that have been great in the Word of God. We have the Great Flood. How about that? Was there not a time of purging and cleansing that had to go on during that time in the Old Testament days with Noah and the Ark in that flood? Yes, we do. We had that time of purging that we deal with. I call it right now, and what the Lord, it is on God's heart in this hour for believers and for us to come together. We've had, unfortunately, the Great Divide that we needed. And it seems at times where there's so much lack of communication and there's lack of basics of principles of God's word of mercy and truth and righteousness and love and grace and forgiveness, that has created such a great divide in people's minds and hearts and souls. And we all know that people all over the world are praying for unity. But I want to share with you something on that part as we're going into this thing about the purge. Light and darkness do not mix. You cannot bring them together and have light and darkness. You have light and you have darkness. And you have Jesus Christ, who is always calling and commissioning us, even in the book of Colossians. He's called us to come out of darkness and walk into his marvelous light. That means a lot for us right now. And then we have in this that God is taking us into, that he has called us, all of us believers, the Great Commission. And it's interesting because when I was even thinking of that word, Great Commission, and how does this work? There are even believers in this hour that are making excuses and they're justifying what's going on. Well, this person, I can't deal with this person in salvation. I can't move and have salvation come here. I don't dare speak these things. We're having even all of these areas tested in our lives in such a great way. That brings us in the cry of our heart. It has been consistently for years with revival, the Great Awakening. But in the Great Awakening, what needs to go on is the Great Purge. Where, and you use that word purge, it was interesting because our pastor was sharing about it this morning. Amazing how God works. And when I think of the word purge, one word pops up to me, blood. The blood of Jesus. The cleansing flow and the power of the cleansing flow of Jesus that we needing to look at, and we're needing to allow that work. Because as I said earlier today, even this morning, on this day of the 17th that we're looking at, that's always the finishing, the completion, the perfecting. And I can't think of anything more when I think of that and I think of the purge, we think about the blood of Jesus. There it is. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Because that blood of Jesus in the purge that we're looking at, in the words that we think about in the purge, and of that, when I think of that word purge, I think purify. I think of that word purge, I think of sanctify. When I think of that word purge, I think of consecrate. When I think of that word, I'm hearing all the time that word separate. Separate ourselves from light and darkness. And what does that? The blood of Jesus brings us into that place to be able to do that. A scripture that is so powerful and so simple and so sure that we speak about all the time is Romans 12, 1 and 2. That we cannot even remove ourselves from in this hour, and maybe have not looked at it that it's a cleansing, but it is, because we have that mandate from the Lord that he says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that we present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service. It's interesting because we all know even the enemies of this world and the enemies of systems of darkness, they love using that word purge. Isn't that wild? And yet it's all about, and as we were even doing the worship song earlier, it's time for us to become clean. Become clean and holy before the Lord. And of course, when we were reading this in Romans 12, 1 and 2, that we present ourselves. Hallelujah. Now, many of us have presented ourselves even these months and even these days and in these hours. We presented ourselves at times maybe unclean before the Lord. And we need to look at what that means. Interesting. When I was researching some of this and looking at this, the one that we've used constantly in revival is Psalm 51, that the psalmist David said when he said, create in us a pure heart, a clean heart, purge with hyssop. Hallelujah. That purging, that cleansing that needs to come from this, that we need to look at. Also, I remember even years ago when I was a young, new believer, one of the challenges that the Lord was bringing into my life was to study the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews, I've always called as the blood book. Hallelujah. Because it's all about the blood of Jesus. And it's not just the act of what he's done for us, but it's the covenant of that lifestyle, of the entrance that we have into the things of God because and through and by the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. In that place, the Lord was giving me the direction in this hour. And in this coming into Martin Luther King, coming up and coming into all what's going to be going on, even I call that historically and even politically, all these next few weeks, there's a very interesting mandate the Lord is giving us, that we are purging ourselves from dead works. We are purging ourselves, and we're allowing the sprinkling of the blood from an evil conscience. Let's talk about that for a minute, because the word conscience is something so powerful that we need to look at. And we cannot look at that unless we have the blood of Jesus, because there's all kinds of consciences. And we need to purge ourselves, and there's a mandate. We have, of course, in the book of Hebrews, chapter 9, that we're looking at, glory to God. We also have that, which is the blood covenant chapter that I have shared over and over again. Hebrews 9, verse 4, and Hebrews 10, verse 22. It's giving us the mandate, our consciences. They're even directing and being very specific. We are to purge ourselves from the evil conscience. Hallelujah. Check it out. Evil conscience. Now, it's amazing because so many people nowadays are being dictated and they're being controlled, and their acts that's going on and what's happening, contrary to the word of God, they're operating with an evil conscience. Hallelujah. The Lord has called us to have a pure conscience. He's called us to have a good conscience. Hallelujah. A good conscience, which is in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 16, that we need to look at. But part of that, if we have allowing the purging and the cleansing flow of the blood of Jesus to do that work in us, which, by the way, demonstrates the finished work of the cross, that takes us then into the freedom to walk into what we need to be walking into in this hour, that our focus and our state and our spiritual condition will be coming from a pure conscience. Yes, we need to have a good conscience, but it needs to be pure. And we all know that when we make decisions and choices and that our actions, there's some areas the Lord was sharing with me on some of this as well, that in the dead works, we are to be purged from the dead works. And from the dead works, we know when something is dead, there's not life. There's not fruit coming from it. And we all know religion is one that captures and gets a hold of our souls and our minds and our mindsets, that we get so wrapped up in works that this keeps us at a distance away from that place of intimacy with the Lord and coming into that intimacy and knowing that will bring us to make wrong decisions, choices, and commissions. I use that word, and commitment, because when we talk about the Great Commission, we need to become committed to what God is calling us to do so that souls will come into the kingdom of God. But they come in with that evil conscience. That's part of the worldly conscience that we have, that we can be maybe morally correct in many areas, which is thus the beginning, but a moral conscience is not enough in this hour. Being good is not enough in this hour, but we need to have our pure conscience come forth, because the other is evil. The other kind of consciences we're looking at and we're hearing, and we're seeing so many levels and patterns of sin that are going on throughout the world, even nowadays, even in this era, even in this year, 2021, no matter what generation that's going on and that what's happening, is that we need to come to terms with some of these areas, because what has brought us into will be the dead works, purging us from works that have created us to have our conscience that is maybe amoral, which is the opposite of moral. And again, we're talking about that is evil and the working of evil that's in people's hearts and minds and souls at times will allow people to operate in unrighteous deeds, unholy acts. My goodness, A-C-T-S. Because what it boils down to, my dear people, and we have here even in Hosea, when you even do history-wise, when we have that right kind of purge and cleansing that God is doing and purifying in us, we will do right at what is right in God's eyes. We will do right and we will see and we will do what is right in God's eyes, no matter what is being presented to us, no matter where the enemy at times will push us or pressure us in this hour. And even as we're looking at what's going to be taking place in our nation in the next few days and what people are praying and they're crying out for in this time of wanting peace in their cities, and they want to begin to have our cities be rebuilt and homes come back in and families come in, whether it's been from part of that great divide also because of COVID. Hallelujah. But the Lord God wants us to come back to that place in Him in this year 2021. Hallelujah. That those things that have propelled us to move away from God, those things that have brought us, again, that we need to be purged from, maybe false teachings, false ideologies taking place, false religions going on, hallelujah, that have allowed us to do what has been, as I dare say, what has been wrong, what has been willful, what has been unholy, what has been unrighteous, what has been unloving, what has been unforgiving. This is all parts of the behavior and the attitude of those that have been operating in an evil conscience. Hallelujah. Interesting. When I was praying about this, when the Lord was saying it's time for our consciences to become purged and have us in that place for this, He wants to give us the fullness of what He's promised us. He wants to give us what He has spoken to us, whether it's the Logos of the Word or the Rhema of the Word. And we'll go there for that in a minute. But if our consciences are not cleansed before the Lord, we will have the wrong motive. We will have the wrong kind of patterns of living and lifestyle, which brings us also in that what we're looking at. We'll do this another time, but the purging from iniquity. We have purging from the transgressions, which is part of the acts that have created us to do certain kinds of sin. But when you have purging from iniquity and the iniquitous patterns of sin, we go into the deeper parts of sin that have happened, that have been even embedded into generations, that have been even embedded into our bloodlines, in families, in generations, that have even been embedded in what the cities and the states and even some of the countries have been locked into through war and through the evil, unholy workings of many things that have taken place that have created an evil conscience. One of the people I think about, which I know all of you can relate to, was Hitler. Evil conscience. Pure example. And yet, What he did was unthinkable, and he did what was horrible, yet in his mind, he was operating in a purge. How about that? He was purging the Jews from what he felt was in our country, that they were unholy and that they were unthinkable even to be human beings, because he was taken over by that of the enemy. And I look at even the things that have been going on, that have been happening, even the last few years, believe it or not, in our United States of America, and even then in other countries and in other generations. My goodness. So much of us have been led and guided by an evil conscience. Hallelujah. And as we look for, and we're crying out for revival, we're crying out, Lord God, in that revival, there's got to be a purging. Because then we begin to recognize, we begin to awaken, we begin to not just then acknowledge that God, who he is, and acknowledges that Jesus died for us, and that he was buried for us and rose again for us, but then we begin to move forward in that revelation, in that truth, because something begins to happen in our conscience and we're not focused and directed and controlled by our own set of values that have been in sin consciousness. But we have been removed from that because of the blood of Jesus. That's where the power comes in Hebrews 9, verse 4, and Hebrews 10, 22. But let me share this with you that I want to read to you, that I think is very important. And I'm in the book of Romans. I'm in King James for those of you that are following through the Word of God today, because I need to set you up to look at, to see where, what has been happening. How does it become in that we begin to operate with that evil conscience without the blood of Jesus? What begins to happen in our lives? I'll show it to you. It is in Romans, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, they have not submitted themselves unto the rightness and the righteousness of God. There it is. There it is in a nutshell. There has been not that submission. There has not been that surrender. There has not been that yielding that we need to have. And yet, it is so clear when God says you're to be purged from an evil conscience. You'll be purged from dead works that go on. Hallelujah. It's interesting because when we get into that place, into that condition that God is setting us up to be, having that kind of right kind of conscience, then we begin to have the ability to abide in him. We have that ability to stay abiding in him. When we come into that place of abiding with the Lord, we know then that we have come into that place of that great purge, that we begin to recognize God. It's amazing. Even in the Old Testament, they talked about that we were of filthy rags, and that we were covered in our own blood. And they're using that example of Ezekiel. And they were moving forward and sharing this. But I came, and as you spread your skirts out that I brought then, and I put new garments on you, and you were washed and you were cleansed. This is what God is wanting us to move and come into as an individual, as a people, as a corporate church body, and as a corporate group of believers, an end time army of the Lord in this hour. Because then we will not be influenced, hallelujah, by unholy acts. My goodness, there's so much of that that has been going on. We will not be controlled by those unrighteous deeds that come up. Because when, as I read in Romans chapter 10, they were being ignorant of God's righteousness. If we're ignorant of God's righteousness, what are we going to begin to fall into? The trap of the enemy. What do we begin to fall into? That place where we begin to dictate by what is in our own mind, in our own conscience, in our own set of rules and regulations. And dare I say that we won't even come in and change and interpret and bring in our understanding of what we see the Bible to be in the Word of God. Which puts us, again, folks, that place of deception. We don't want to be a deceived people. But if people are in that evil kind of conscience and they're in that place, they won't be part of the great purge. In this hour, when there is every area and every evidence throughout this world, through cities and states and countries and nations, and through churches, that's all going on. Everything's being turned around. Everything's trying to be topsy-turvy, turning the word to fit the occasion and not allowing the pure word of God to do the work that it needs to do. Because there is, again, there's two sets of ways the word will work, and that is even in this, in the purge, there's the logos and in the rhema. And when you have the logos of the word, that is the self-existence of God. That is God's word himself from Genesis to Revelation. That is there. That has been set. That has been established. Not creating our own kind of righteousness, but allowing the righteousness of God from Genesis to Revelation to come into our hearts and our minds. And then he gives us the rhema word of God, which is when we are in the rhema word of God. This is through the mind of God. He speaks to us. He speaks to us through the rhema. And in that rhema in itself of the movement by the power and the unction and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, that rhema word of God will determine what type of righteousness are we in. It will do a cleansing, a beautiful cleansing and a purging in our minds, in our consciousness, in our consciousness, that we will be removed from all form of sin consciousness if we come into that place of forgiveness and accepting and receiving forgiveness, mercy, and grace. Because what we have done, as I said in Romans 12, 1 and 2, we have presented ourselves before the Lord. We have submitted and we have surrendered. And what we have surrendered to the simplicity and yet to the power that's behind it is, Lord, I need you now. I need you more than ever. Lord, I am a sinner. I want to be saved by grace. I want that salvation and that power and that authority and that dominion and that purity of having a saved walk and relationship with you be in my life. I want to be purged from everything that has gone on, even in that of my family lines, even in that in the bloodlines of my family. If there's been addictions in the families, if there's been areas of alcoholism, if there's been violence or abuse, if there's been sexual sins that have gone on, if there's been any other form of pattern and habit and behavior that has gone on, hallelujah, we say to the Lord, I repent. I repent, I repent, I repent, I repent, because in that there is a purging that begins to move in which we need to be having in this hour. Hallelujah. We're praying for peace, but you can't have peace unless we get purged from what's inside of us and what we've allowed to be inside of us. And again, how do we work with that? Faith without works is dead. Hallelujah. So we also have the faith of God that will propel us and that will empower us to move forward and say, Lord, I don't want to have this kind of conscience going on in my life anymore. We need to have that so that the fulfillment, the what he has promised us, will be able to come forth regardless of what's taking place and what's happening. Let me give you a few areas of the words of purge. When I think of the areas, and what do I call it? I call it the weapons of our purge. in this hour. The blood of Jesus is that of the purge. We talk about that of the fire of the Holy Spirit, where the Word of God says, even in the book of Malachi, in the last chapters of Malachi, that the Word is that of refining fire and of that of fuller's soap. That's the cleansing right there. And then we have the Word itself, that we are to be cleansed by the Word of God. Because we all know words will create life or they will create death. And if we allow ourselves to succumb to the words that are being given by the world and by areas of evil groups of people in all stages of life that are not according to God and His Word, and that will have us in opposition to the Lord, we will be living and breathing. We will say, yes, Lord, but we will still have an evil conscience. When that happens, judgment on ourselves takes place, not of the Lord. What takes place is then that we will be allowing the wrong kind of fruit coming into our lives, where we're to be set apart and sanctified. Now, what I think is very interesting also, I believe it is in the book of Timothy. We have here what God shows us, even in the book of Timothy. And as we're going there, I want to go to Jeremiah. Because part of that work of the weapons that we're looking for, as we go in a little bit to the book of Timothy, we got the blood, we have the fire, we have the Word, we have the Holy Spirit, we have the truth. And then I want to talk about Jeremiah. Because we are all that, and we need to be of that, because the Lord has given that to each one of us. Because what He said in Jeremiah chapter 1, and He said it in verse 10, and I'm reading out of New Living. Lord, He said to Timothy, and He says to us, I put my words in your mouth. I appoint you, that's for us in this hour, to stand up against nations and kingdoms. Some of it we must uproot and tear down. Destroy others and overthrow. Others you must build up and plant. Hallelujah. It's interesting, because after that, then there came the vision that Jeremiah began to have. Because the Lord said, look, Jeremiah, what do you see? And Jeremiah replied, I see a branch from an almond tree. And the Lord said, that's right. And it means that I am watching, and I will certainly carry out all my plans. Hallelujah. God is watching us in this hour. He's looking over us in this hour. The work of God and the finished work of the cross never stops, because the blood of Jesus is moving in us. That blood of Jesus is allowing that of David that goes over and over and over again in Psalm 51. When his prayer and the cry of his heart was always, create in me a right, pure spirit. Create in me a pure heart. Purge me with hyssop, Lord. And that's what we're looking for, and that's what we're moving in, where God is directing us to in this hour, that we need to deal with. Because when that happens, we move into that place that God gives us. And He wants to see that more than even what we want to see of ourselves. Now, when we talk about Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 9, 1 Timothy chapter 4. Interesting, I want to share something with you, because I was like going, oh my goodness, when I looked at this. And it happens to be, of course, in the danger of the last days. I'm going to read this to you, because this is the area of the purging that needs to go on. This is what we need to look at in this hour that God is doing. and it was called The Danger of the Last Days. Timothy, these last days will be very difficult times. Hallelujah. Sounds a little bit like what we're going through. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and they will be proud. They will be scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others, have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. And what did God tell him? Stay away, Timothy, from people like that. I think that's amazing. When we have that of the false and the counterfeit and those that are operating with that evil conscience, many of them thinking, knowing, believing, this is what they need to be doing because they've been overtaken by so much that's gone on. We have here again in chapter 3 of 2 Timothy, these teachers will oppose the truth. They have depraved minds and a counterfeit faith. Hallelujah. Does that not sound like so many areas of what we are literally moving, breathing, walking in? And what was told to Timothy in this time that we're looking for, that we're dealing with, that we're saying, Lord, purge us. Just like David said, create in me a clean heart. Renew in me a right spirit. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. This is what was given to Timothy. This is what is given to us. But you, Timothy, here we are. You certainly know what I teach and how I live and what my purpose in life is. You know my faith, my patience, my love, and my endurance. Wow. When we come into that place of purging, what happens? Our faith comes alive. What happens in that purging? We have patience to have God do his perfect work in us of maturing, growing, and developing. In the book of James, all the book of James, hallelujah, is a power-packed work. And I say it's a work, not just a book. It's a work that God is doing and does in us as we look into that book. And here it is. My love and my endurance. What is it that we've seen so much that people's love has grown cold? Hallelujah. We need to see that fire of God come in. We need to be electrified with the love of Christ in us. Because as we're living in this age, in this system, in this time, in this era, even in 2021, starting off, the love of God, the agape love of God, is being absolutely removed in so many places, even in Christians, because many of our hearts have become hard-hearted. Many of us have become strong-willed in our own minds. Many of us that we have then succumbed and our consciences have come to that place where we cannot afford to have an evil conscience. Hallelujah. And yet many of us need to come back in and not to be in that place, in that wrong path that comes in with this. Because here, you know how much persecution and suffering I have endured. This is Paul talking to Timothy. You know all about it. But God says, this is what we need to look at in verse 13. But evil people and imposters will flourish. They will deceive others and will themselves be deceived. And what is telling us? We must remain faithful to the things that we have been taught. Because you know those things are true. We know those things you can trust. You have been taught the Holy Scriptures from childhood. You have been given the wisdom to receive this salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. That's that place. It's not just a movement of prayer, people of God, where people are praying. Sometimes we get so caught, Lord, I'm praying for the nation. Lord God, I'm praying for the elections. I'm praying for the inaugurations. I'm praying for the cities and the states, and all that is good. Hallelujah. But we all need to be praying that we all come back to God. That we come back to God individually, corporately, as family. The churches come back to God. There is such a movement to keep churches shut down. My goodness, I was talking to a woman even the other day, and the greatest place of evangelism many times is the grocery store. Because everybody's got to eat, and those that are not afraid to go out to the stores and do what's right and shopping and not just go ahead online and stay at home and do this, that has become the hub where people will talk and where people will come to communicate. It's amazing what I've seen. And one woman came up to me. I was talking to her. And it is amazing. You never would think you would hear this words. But this woman who was a believer, she said to me, our church just doesn't meet anymore. Churches, do we hear this? Churches, you're not meeting anymore. Hallelujah. What is it that we need to be moving in, coming together? That doesn't need to be purged from us. That is not an act or an unholy or an unrighteous act, and it's not where just COVID and the disease seems to be birthing and spreading. Hallelujah. Because the churches that are of God are wrapped up into be in the presence of God. We need to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. That'll be in that place that we can beginning to grow and develop and mature to be that church that God calls forth. And what is he calling us as a church in this hour? And he's coming back to the church that we are a bride without spot or wrinkle. Hallelujah. God is purging those blemishes from our minds and our hearts that are going on. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2 again in this. Hallelujah. If you keep yourself pure, you will be a special vessel for honorable use. Your life will be clean. You will be ready for the master to use you for every good work. Dead work? No. Good work. Hallelujah. And that comes in that place that we, as we've been purged and saying, Lord, purge us from areas that we've been religious. Purge us, Lord, where we've been sanctimonious. That is not the same thing as being sanctified with the Lord. But there is that religious self-righteousness that's locked into that word of being even self-serving, sanctimonious before the Lord. And yet God has called us to be servants, servants of the Most High God. He's called us to be purged vessels that we're looking at and that we need to move into in this. And the biggest area that's also being challenged that we need to look at in this hour is that truth, the truth of God and his word and the principles of the word of God, they have been pressured in many places and in many, many, many groups and peoples that we need the truth purged from us. And the truth that is of God is what sets us free. For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. The Holy Spirit, he is a spirit of truth. Hallelujah. Truth in God. Not truth based on what we've been having in our evil consciences. Not truth based on having what we've even just been saying, well, I'm a moral person. I'm a good person. That is not going to cut it with the Lord. Because the works of God need to reflect from the works of the cross and the works of what Jesus has done in our life so that we will have that kind of lifestyle that is purged and clean and holy and true and forgiving and merciful and loving and righteous and joyful before the Lord, that we will not be caught into that place where nowadays we're having to really look at and see where we need to be the purging from unclean spirits and the reality of unclean spirits that have been around us, and that what the world is offering to us, and the world is saying, this is what you need to believe in. This is what I'm allowing you and for the generations to come and what's going to be happening. You can believe in any of these things. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And yet, the word that comes from that and what the world is offering to us is we need to be happy. We need to have our happiness determined by these areas and what God has placed in us, not in God, in us. And yet we all know there's a difference in that purging, that even in that place that we all have to be happy. It's like many times there are even plaques, and I even laugh at them. They say, go to your happy place. Hallelujah. Find what is your happy place. And yet the Lord is saying, I want you to find what is the holy place. I want you to find, to come into that place, what is your secret place with me. Hallelujah. With the Lord. In Psalm 91, that does not change, that never changes. Hallelujah. It's amazing, because when I look at even that with Josiah, I always say his name wrong. Hallelujah. But in that place, that is that goes with that. It's second, let me go there. It's, believe it's Second Chronicles. Hallelujah. Yeah. Second Chronicles, Hosiah. Would he ruled in Judah? 34, Hosiah. Josiah, however you want to call it. Josiah or Hosiah, he was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 31 years. And here's the key. This is what God's looking for. This is part of the purge that we need to look at. If you want to know what this means, P-U-R-G-E says, Josiah did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight, and he followed the example of his ancestor David. Now, here we go. I want to read this to you because this is what we're being challenged in this hour. And that was 2 Chronicles chapter 34, verse 2. Josiah began to seek the God of his ancestor David. And in the 12th year, he began to purge Judah and Jerusalem, destroying all the pagan shrines, the Asherah poles, the carved idols, and the cast images. Look at in verse 4. He ordered that the altars of Baal be demolished, and that the incense altars which stood above them broken down. And he made sure that the Asherah poles and the idols and the images were scattered, and they were burned. Hallelujah. Boy, what would happen in this country? What would happen in this city? In the city, in the countries, in the nations, in this world, if we begin to see some of this happen. Hallelujah. Well, hallelujah. We've seen the opposite happen in so many places. We've seen so many things that have been burned down. We've seen so many things that have been destroyed, things that have been based on history. People call some of that prejudice, and so they had to be cut down, removed, and even the names of things removed. But with the name of Jesus, that name of Jesus cannot be removed. When there is that place of that purge that God has done in placing in us individually, corporately, and in this hour, and he has us begin to rise up as an army of the Lord, those things that people have said that had need to be removed and all of history to be changed, what about the history of the church? What about the history of what Jesus has done? That is not just history. It's based us and set us up for eternity. You can't erase eternity. Hallelujah. but we can begin to see our minds be set apart, be sanctified, hallelujah, by the truth of God's word, hallelujah, that God's word is not a curse. To be a believer in Christ Jesus, the word is not a curse, because we are to believe that as Jesus was our Savior and that we were sinners, yet came into that place with him, and that was counted of righteousness unto us. That we begin to be operating in that belief system that is of God. Because when we operate in that belief system of God, we then begin to see that great purge come into our lives. And we are in this year 2021. We see we want the end of those areas that have been counted as slavery, and the conditions of slavery in our minds, in our hearts, in our lifestyles, that we don't have those areas of sin and those patterns of iniquity and those bloodlines, even in our families, that will cross into all generations, no matter what party you're of. Hallelujah. But we become that citizens. Not just of the United States of America, of other countries and nations. We become citizens of the Most High God. Hallelujah. And in that is our loyalty to Jesus. Glory to God. The loyalty that God is looking for in us. Because those of us out there throughout the world, no matter what color you are, it's not about color. It's not about race. It's even bigger and deeper. It's all about having that place with the Lord. Believers in Christ Jesus. Believers in the one true God. That puts us into that place. That we begin to operate in what God's given us. Look at this also in 2 Timothy. Hallelujah. I'm in chapter 3. Verses 16 and 17. All scripture. Do you hear? All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true, to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong, teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. If we are equipped and prepared with the fullness of the gospel, not just the partial, because you see, when we come in and we enter in and we say, Lord, I want to be purged from those areas and even the mindsets that maybe we've had in areas of teaching, of doctrine, that so we will not succumb, because we need to be purged. And some of us in this hour, and even those of you listening today, you are praying for relatives and you're praying for people that have surrendered and submitted themselves to the wrong God, to the God of this world, that are believing and they're trusting in the doctrines that we have in the Word of God, the doctrines of devils, the doctrines of demons. And yet God has called us to be believers in his word. Hallelujah. We don't need to be purged from his word. We don't need to be purged from the way. And it's not the way that seemeth right. Hallelujah. That brings death but does evil. Hallelujah. But of the way of the Lord. That has never changed in God's word, because God's word says to us through Jesus, which will never change, I made a way where there's been no way. That's from the power of the cross. And to the power of the cross, we then have the Holy Spirit's power and anointing and unction, hallelujah, and equipping that God is giving us in this hour to do what is right in the eyes of God. We will not fall prey to that of the unrighteous that is going on around us. God says in his word that my righteous shall never be moved. Hallelujah. Of those of us that are in the sight of God. But in order for us to come in the sight of God, we have to receive and accept the power of the purging, cleansing flow of the blood of Jesus. I remember, we have a few minutes left still here on this. Years ago when I was learning to come into the areas in the ministry, and I was struggling, not with my own lifestyle, but I was struggling through people bringing up the past in my life, bringing up areas of past sins in my life and things that were going on. And I was trying not to come and succumb into those areas years ago. I'll never forget, there was a very wise minister came up to me one day. And I was trying so hard to belong and to accept and to do what was right. People would tell me, well, you need to do this and you need to do that and you need to do this. And I go, okay, I'll do it. Because I was so hungry for God. And this is at times so many of us, and who I'm talking to in this hour, you have struggled with some of these things too, or even in your own mind, or even with people that have loved you, or people that thought that was right, that you thought were right to be in your life and they weren't, and the things that go on. The minister comes up to me and says, the most important thing that you must allow God to do in your life, never let go of the cleansing power of the blood of Jesus. And I remember when that person said that to me, something happened in my conscience. Something began to happen, and I began to realize, as we all know, there's life in the blood of Jesus. There's always life in that blood of Jesus and what takes place. And in that, I began to realize, I'm going to be okay. I'm going to be okay. Look at this in 1 Timothy. Let me read this to you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. This is what we're looking at as we begin to close some of this out today. Here it is again, folks. You better have an ear to listen on this. The Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last times, some will turn away from the true faith. They will follow deceptive spirits, teachings that come from demons. These people are hypocrites, they are liars, and their consciences are dead. We need to look at that, because there are those that have said that even when you have that evil conscience, it's though that we have been seared with a hot iron. Hallelujah. I don't know if any of you even experienced what it's like and had anything like that go on in your life when you've had that kind of work, or you've been around it and you've seen something that has been seared with a hot iron. It seems to leave an indelible mark that can never go away. Hallelujah. But folks, I have hope for you today. Hope, I have faith for you today. I have God's word. I've got heaven's backing today. And God says, but God, hallelujah, but through God in Christ Jesus, hallelujah. You will continue to be able to walk in that relationship with him. You will be able to continue to move forward because of the cleanliness of his love and of his mercy and of his grace that he's wanting to pour in us, and that's what we need to be praying, declaring, and decreeing in our nation in this hour. I remember even back then in the 50s, the 60s, and 70s, and the movements that go on, there would be people on the streets, and they would be saying, give peace a chance. I say to you today, give faith in God a chance. And allow ourselves to come into that place of purging. There's a beautiful worship song that I want us to hear the words, and I want us to be penetrated through the power and the unction of the Holy Spirit as we close out on this today. That will take us throughout this week and this hour going on. And it's called Clean by Natalie Grant. That we need to move forward and have in place in our lives. Because that is where God is moving and taking us, so we can come into that place of being face to face. But in order to be face to face, we need to be clean. And we need to have that song of praise and worship that God is calling us into. And again, I want all of you to be able to worship in this time and worship in this hour as we look at that worship song that is called Clean by Natalie Grant. Because we're never going to find anything else. We will not find peace.
This is right.
We will not find grace. We will not find mercy. We will not be able to do what is right in the sight of God. But we need to move forward, and we need to be forward as vessels. So we need to hear and listen and receive the worship on this. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, yes.
You're restoring me.
That's our prayer.
Piece by piece.
That's our prayer, individually, corporately.
There's nothing too dirty.
Thank you, Jesus.
That you can't make worthy.
Hallelujah.
You wash me in mercy.
Yes, Lord. That's our declaration.
There's nothing too dirty.
Yes, Lord.
That you can't make worthy.
Thank you, Lord.
You wash me in mercy. I am clean.
That's that sanctification. That's the separateness unto the Lord God in this hour.
What was dead now.
Thank you, Lord. This is the purge.
Lives again.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
My heart's beating.
Yes.
Beating inside my chest. Oh, I'm coming alive with joy and destiny. Oh, oh.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
There's nothing to do.
Thank you, Jesus.
That you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean.
Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Your blood flowed red, it made me white. My dirty rags are purified. I am clean.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Washed in the blood of your sacrifice. Your blood flowed red, it made me white.
The blood of Jesus. Yes.
Washed in the blood of your sacrifice. Your blood flowed red and made me white. My dirty rags.
Thank you, Lord.
Purified.
Yes.
I'm clean.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm clean. I'm clean.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
You make me clean.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We close out in this word. Don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. Never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble and keep on praying. When God's people are in need, we will be ready to help them. Be eager to practice hospitality. And I throw this word out there right now. Bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Be happy with those who are happy and weep with those that are weep. Live in harmony with each other. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. And don't think you know it all. Never pay back evil with more evil. Do things in such a way that everyone can see you're honorable. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of God. For scripture says, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. And I want to give you the last of this. Do not let evil conquer you, but conquer evil by doing good in this great purge. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, today for your day. Let this word be seared in us in this hour. In Jesus' name, amen.